Had a good Friday morning to you. It's Bryan Nehman along with Torrey Snow, who is in for C4 today. Pleased to be joined by Major Garrett, Chief Washington Correspondent for CBS News. Face the Nation will air at 2 o'clock Sunday afternoon here on WBAL. And Major's also the host of the Takeout Podcast, which airs at noon here Sundays on WBAL. Had Governor Hogan on not too long ago. Good morning, Major.
Good morning, Bryan. How are you, my brother?
I'm doing well. Good to hear your voice again. I have to say, you know, Afghanistan, this has been an unbelievable week. I think one of the most tumultuous weeks we've seen in our country, especially for a foreign policy decision made by a president. The president's and his defiant interview the other day with ABC mm-hmm. News, you know, the Wall Street Journal report that the State Department was warned by diplomats about this. Give us yep. your sense of where we are, you know, in this 20 years that we've been in Afghanistan.
So I'll deal with the last part of your question, the 20 years in Afghanistan, in a second, because it's very relevant to where we are now. But here's the situation, and I listen to the president closely, but he can't really believe all that he is saying, because he's essentially telling the country the following scenario, which is the real one right now, is acceptable. Americans at risk in Afghanistan making their way to the airport to be evacuated on U.S. military flights can only do so with the permission and the sufferance of the Taliban. How can that be an acceptable scenario?
Wow.
And to those in the administration who would say, well, what could we have done? Here's a suggestion. Many people outside the Biden administration and within it were saying, look, what's the worst case scenario? Could Kabul fall and the country fall rapidly? Well, potentially, yes. Look, it was President Biden who circled the date, August 31st. That was his decision. He's had to ask the question, what's the worst thing that could happen that could flow from that decision? Well, you could have the scenario we're in right now, which is pretty close to worst case. How do you prevent that? Well, the existing government, the Ghani government, which was still there, you could say, you know what, we're going to push out the perimeter of your airport, and we're going to have designated transit lines, meaning roads to get to the airport for Americans and Afghan allies, and you're going to agree to that. And then if the government fell and the Taliban came into Kabul, you'd say, you know what? We have this designated stuff and we're protecting it. Do you want to fight us over it? I'm pretty sure the Taliban would have said no. All I'm saying is there could have been measures taken and you could have assumed the worst and prepared for the worst. But it's clear that didn't happen, and we are where we are.
Major Garrett, when you do, you know, there is talk about potential confrontation, and the administration overall does seem to be hesitant to even risk a confrontation. What do you feel is the calculus of President Biden to say that this is better than potentially risking a confrontation?
Well, the confrontation is we don't know where all the Taliban fighters are. We know they are a number of them in Kabul, and we don't know what the situation would be. Say there's a firefight, and say there's a firefight at the airport. All right. Well, that means you can't safely bring Americans there, which means they've got to stay where they are. All right. And if you're fighting the Taliban, in which areas and from what sides and at what hours of the day and what are your operational goals? Are you trying to press out 6 blocks, 8 blocks, 10 blocks? And once you secure those, do you have enough troops to protect them once you have created a flank behind you? I mean, all of these things are very real, and it's very tough for the U.S. military right now. And so the safest, most orderly of the worst-case scenario is hold the airport, and if people get there, get them out. But let me direct your attention to a secondary problem, which is getting worse by the hour in Doha, Qatar, which is where flights with Afghan allies are landing.
Right.
There are no facilities there to process them, nothing. They have no AC, they have no food, they have no bathrooms. This is becoming a sprawling humanitarian crisis by the hour. Again, why? No plan, no preparation, and now, last minute, slapdash execution.
Man, it's incredible. I know you don't have a whole lot of time on this, but do you get to send, I mean, I listened to General Milley the other day and the Secretary of Defense, and I could not believe what they were saying, that, you know, well, you know, there are Americans there, we're going to try to get them out. There was no, mm-hmm. hey, we're going to get them out. The French are in there. The Brits are apparently in there. Do you have a sense, and maybe in your reporting, that the intelligence community and the military are at odds with the White House, or are they all on the same page?
Well, look, the military takes the orders of the commander-in-chief, and there is a certain amount of reporting. We have it at CBS, others have it, that military commanders, and they've always said, look, we should stay in Afghanistan and have a certain number of people there for force posture, diplomatic protection, and basically tell the Taliban we're still here. But when the president said we're out and we're leaving on August 31st, and I think the key day in all this was essentially handing the keys over to Bagram Airfield, then the Taliban knew from that moment forward there was no close air support, which is one of the things that had fortified Afghan army personnel to fight the Taliban, knowing that it would always be U.S. military personnel coming in the sky to give them backup. That actually made them braver and better soldiers. And tens of thousands of Afghan army personnel have died fighting the Taliban. But when that close air support went away and disappeared, as it did a couple of months ago, they're like, this is a fight we're only going to lose, and we've got to cut the best deal we can. And all those things were warned to this administration, all of them. But they didn't hear them, or if they heard them, they dismissed them. And now we are where we are.
Amazing. Governor Hogan on Face the Nation this weekend, right?
Yes, he is, in part because we had our great conversation in Annapolis with the governor on the takeout. Yeah. And we also have Nikki Haley for her first interview, Ryan Crocker, ambassador to both Iraq and Afghanistan, withering critic of President Biden in this current circumstance, and whomever the White House puts up to speak on its behalf, we'll have that guest as well. We just don't know who it is.
Always great to have you on, Major. Take care. We'll talk to you down the road, I hope.
Thank you, sir.